Hey, greetings and God bless you. I'm Elder Terrence W. Carr, the senior elder here at the Word Church. And our pastor and first lady are out on a well-deserved timeout celebrating First Lady Vernon's birthday. But let me tell you, there is a word in the house on today. Come on in and join us for our worship service. I'm going to be preaching the word today. I'm going to preach a message to what I've given the title, I Won't Go Back. So I want you to enjoy this word. And listen here, while you're out there on YouTube, we want you to like, comment, and subscribe. That's right. Like our page, subscribe to our page, and put some comments in there. It helps the algorithm to build our audience. We appreciate you. Come on into the worship. You there in Exodus 14, 15? Then the Lord said to Moses, "Why are you crying out to me? Tell the sons of Israel to go forward." Let me say that again. Then the Lord said unto Moses, "Why are you crying out to me? Tell the sons of Israel to go forward." I want to see who's going to help me preach this morning. And if you would, in your best preacher voice, look at somebody and tell them, "I won't go back." Yeah. Now tell somebody else, "I won't go back." Make it a declarative imperative. "I won't go back. I won't. All right. Well, you may be seated in the sanctuary. Man, I love the Old Testament because one of the things that the Old Testament does, it really shows me how good the Word of God fits together. The Old Testament is filled with what we call shadows and types. Shadow is a reflection of something that we see in the New Testament that's realized, but the principle was introduced. A type is a model of something that you see in the New Testament. And in our text today, we see the children of Israel are coming out of bondage in Egypt. Egypt is a type of sin. And so they're coming out of this bondage. They are being delivered. But I want you to understand something about deliverance. Deliverance is not complete simply when you come out of something. No. God takes us out from something to put us into something. And so our deliverance is complete when God moves us from one place to another place. But in that transition is the place we call the middle. It is in this place of transition where the moves we make will dictate how long it takes for us to get to our promised place, or whether or not we will arrive there at all. And so in our text, we see the children of Israel coming out of bondage, but not yet moving into their promised land because they are, as I would say, stuck in the middle. Has everyone ever been in that place where God brought you out of something, but has not yet brought you into something? And it leaves you in this place where sometimes you feel confused because you seem like you're wandering without aim and that you might not have purpose in that place. And you're wondering what God is up to. But can I borrow the Apostle Paul in Philippians 1:6, where he says, "For I am confident of this very thing, that he who began a good work in you will perfect it unto the day of Christ Jesus." Let me say it this way. If he started something in you, he's going to finish it. He's not going to leave you stranded out there in the middle. He that begun a good work in you will accomplish it until the day of Christ Jesus. So I got a word today for somebody that feels like you're stuck in transition that God is going to take you into. But here's what you got to do. Let me borrow Paul one more again in chapter 3 of Philippians, where he says, verse 12, "Not as though I have already obtained, either were already perfect, but I follow after, if that I may apprehend that which also I am apprehended of Christ. Brethren, I count not myself to have apprehended it, but this one thing I do, forgetting those things which are behind and reaching forth unto those things which are before, I press to the mark for the prize of the high calling of God in Christ Jesus. Do I got anybody in here who made up your mind to press that I'm going forward with God, that I won't go back? I don't care how hard it gets, how difficult it is, what I gotta go through, but I've been through too much to go back. God got me out of it and I refuse to get back in it again. I made up my mind that I won't go back, so I'm pressing on the upward way. New heights I'm gaining every day. Always praying as I'm onward about, Lord, plant my feet on solid ground, because he who begun a good work in me, he's going to finish it. He's going to finish it. I may not be what I ought to be, but I thank God I'm not what I used to be. Is there any transition, saints, that you can say, God, I thank you that I'm not where I used to be? I know there's still some work you got to do in me, but I ain't going back. I'm not nudge your neighbor one more time. Say, I'm not going back. I'm not going back. I know I look good in my Sunday best. I know I look good in my makeup and all that, but you don't know the hell I went through to get here. You don't know the pain I had and the struggles and all that I had to go through. I ain't going back. I'm not. No, no, no. It took too much to get out of that. I'm not going back that way. See, faith keeps us looking forward, not looking back. Because here's what our past is supposed to do. Our past is supposed to prepare us for our future. We ought to gain lessons from our past. Is anybody like me that's on the other side of 50 and pushing your way toward 60 can look back to over your life and said, I've gained some wisdom along the way. There are some things I've learned, and if I could get in the time machine and go back, I wouldn't do that again. I wouldn't go there. I like something that Pastor Vernon says. He asked a question. He says, what if you could have all your stupid money back? Every dollar you spent on something dumb, so every dollar you wasted, how much money would you have right now if you could have all your stupid money back? Would you be a millionaire? If you could have it, there's something my past is supposed to teach me. It's supposed to prepare me for where God has taken me. It's not supposed to keep me and hold me in my past. No, I got to start going forward. I don't want to be stagnant in life. It's said that we ought to always keep moving. We shouldn't get into this stagnant place. As a child of God, you're either growing or regressing. I don't believe there's this place of where you arrive, because long as we're on this side of heaven, there's more that you can do, because not that I've already obtained it or already been made perfect, I press. Any perfect people in the room? Amen. At least you did. Somebody didn't raise their hand. No perfect people. There's nobody perfect. No, but God. So we gotta keep pressing. See, faith keeps us pressing forward. Let's give some background to the text, because we come to this text where we find the children of Israel in bondage. So question goes, how did they get there? Well, first of all, the book of Genesis is the book of beginnings. And in Genesis, we see the beginning of the nation of Israel, the chosen people of God. When in Genesis chapter 12, God speaks to Abraham in his old age and says, get thee up from thy country and thy kindred and go to a land that I will yet show thee, and I'll make of thee a great nation. And Abraham is obedient, and he gets up and he goes and moves, and then God in his old age blesses him with a son, Isaac. And then Isaac has Jacob, and then Jacob has Joseph, and Joseph is the youngest son of Jacob. And Joseph had a vision and a dream that he was going to be great, even greater than his brothers. And he told the vision to his brothers, and the Bible says that his brothers hated him for his vision and his words. So they made up their mind to kill Joseph, but his older brother Judah said, let's not kill him, let's sell him into slavery. You know, Judah means praise, and if I had time, I would preach a message, praise saved my life, because Judah said, that's a whole nother message for another day. Praise saved. Judah said, let's not kill him, but instead sell him into slavery. So they sold Joseph into slavery, but God's favor was all over him. And so even though he was a slave, that God blessed him and blessed all those around him. You ever catch that? Anybody ever say, you know what? You blessed because I'm here. Whew. I remember I was on a plane one time when I was still in the military in the plane, and we was going TDY, so the plane hit some bad turbulence. It was rocking and shaking, and everybody was panicking. I said, y'all all right? This plane can't go down. I'm on it. Don't worry about it. You got favor. Just because I'm here, you're okay. You ought to walk in your job on tomorrow and say, y'all ought to be glad I work here. Oh, be glad I work here because there's favor on my life. And so Joseph had favor on his life. And because of the favor on his life, ultimately, Joseph becomes second to Pharaoh in the land of Egypt. And when a famine came in the land, he brought his own brothers into Egypt, into that place where there was only provision because of Joseph's dream. There was provision in Egypt. And so the children of Israel move into Egypt, and they're sustained because of the favor that's on Joseph. Because faith and favor will keep you in a famine. It'll hold you in a pandemic. It'll keep you when things are low. You gotta have faith, and you gotta learn how to trust God even when stuff don't add up. Isn't it amazing how grandmama got further with less than what we have today? She learned how to make it on scraps. She would take some leftovers and make a delicacy called stew or something of this nature. She knew how to stretch stuff. And let me tell you that when you got faith in God and the favor of God on your life, he will keep you even in the worst of places. Is there anybody here that's been kept? That God held you and maintained you in places that should have killed you? That the reality is that you look much better than what you've been through. The reality is that God has taken care of you. Have any of you ever looked at some of your classmates and said, wait a minute, we graduated the same year? Ooh, you thank God for favor. You thank God that you didn't age like they aged. It's not that you were already perfect or nothing like that. God just didn't let you look like your sin. Yeah, he just kept it off you. And so y'all don't know what I used to do. I look much better than what I was in. Anybody look better than what you was in? So then the children of Israel are in Egypt because of the favor of this own Joseph. But as time would go on, the Bible tells us, Exodus chapter 1, verse 8. Now a new king arose over Egypt who did not know Joseph. Favor gone, didn't know Joseph. And he said to his people, behold, the people of the sons of Israel are more and mightier than we. Come, let us deal wisely with them, or else they will multiply, and in the event of war, they will also join themselves to those who hate us and fight against us and depart from the land. Let me pause, because they were fearful of them, because they saw how strong they were. They said they're more and mightier than us. His mindset, the king, was let's afflict them, let's deal wisely. And you've been trying to figure out why that person on your job keep messing with you. You've been trying to figure out why they don't like you and you ain't done nothing wrong to them. You've been trying to figure it out why they talking about you and all of that, and because they're fearful of you. And it always blows my mind when I find some gorgeous sister that somehow let somebody convince her that she was ugly because somebody teased you and talked about you. But you didn't understand the reason they were talking about you and they hate you is because they can't be you. Mm-hmm. Because your skin's been kissed by God, and because God has blessed you with some full lips and hips, they really wish they had it, that you don't need to get liposuction and Botox and all of that, that God just blessed you with some natural. And they hate us because they ain't us. And you got to make up your mind to say, no. I know who I am in God. Listen, because of their fear of the children of Israel, they said, let us afflict them. Verse 11 says, so they appointed taskmasters over them to afflict them with hard labor. And they built for Pharaoh strong cities, Phittim and Ramses. But here's a verse I love. But the more they afflicted them, the more they multiplied, and the more they spread out, so that they were in dread of the sons of Israel. See, Pharaoh, your plan didn't work. You said, let me afflict them, when you were trying to keep down. But don't you know you can't keep a God man down? You can't keep a God woman down. No, the more they afflicted them, the more they grew. Is there anybody that says, if I can look back over my life, it was the rough patches. It was the time when I was going through that I grew the most, that God matured me. And because I've been through some stuff, I can take much more. Now, God has expanded my capacity. And the stuff that used to bother me don't bother me no more. I don't look for people's approval like I used to look for people's approval, because God approved me. And because I heard what God had to say, I don't need man's commentary. I know who I am. I've been afflicted. And it is through what you go through that you find out who God is. And the reason some folk don't know who God is, you ain't been through nothing. I tell folk, I'm not really living on faith. I'm living in trust, because God has shown up so many times that I know he's a healer. I know he's a deliverer. I know he's a provider. I know he'll make a way out of no way. I know he's a father to a fatherless, a friend to the friendless. I know that God will show up right on time. Because I've been afflicted, I've struggled and been through some stuff, and God showed up time after time after time. Right there he was. The more they afflicted him. Devil, if you knew better, you'd leave me alone. You better stop messing with me, because every time you mess with me, I grow another again. Matter of fact, when I see the enemy start coming, I start looking for my blessing, because I know what, but if there's something coming my way, that God must be about to bless me. That's why I'm going through hell. Anybody catching hell right now and wondering where your blessing is? The more they afflicted them, the more they multiplied, and the more they spread out, so that they were in dread of the sons of Israel. But I want you to know something, because when we're going through, and particularly when we're going through for a long time, it can feel like God doesn't care. Even to the point, God, do you see what I'm going through? God, you see what I'm getting? I'm your child. I've been faithful, at least this week. And I'm wondering why I'm going through this. But Exodus 3, verse 9 says, look, the cry of the people of Israel has reached me, and I've seen how harshly the Egyptians abused them. Now go, for I am sending you to Pharaoh. You must lead my people, Israel, out of Egypt. I want you to catch it. I want you to catch this. Chapter 1 in Exodus, the affliction comes. Chapter 3, God calls Moses to come and deliver his people. But they don't get out into chapter 13 and 14. Now, you got to understand something. They didn't know about God's private conversation with Moses. So while they were sitting there thinking that God doesn't know, God doesn't see, that God was already speaking to the solution. Okay. So you right in your place right now, trying to figure out, does God know? Does God see? Why does it take us so long? You don't know. He's already spoke to your solution. That he's already sent the resolve. He's already given the answer. It's just going to take some time for it to show up. In the midst of that time, that place in the middle, that place of transition, I got to learn to stand in that place, because God is simply preparing you. Sometimes he doesn't take you out too quickly. He let you stay in it. He let you stay in it because he's preparing you, he's maturing you, he's growing. And he knew that he allowed you to get to that place of promise too soon, that when you got to that place, you would mess up when you got there. And so God's got to let you mature before you get to certain places. He'll leave you in there for a little while. Just for a while. And so here's what the text says now. Exodus 13, 17. It says, now when Pharaoh had let the people go, God did not lead them by the way of the land of the Philistines, even though it was near. For God said the people might change their minds when they see war and return to Egypt. Hence God led the people around by the way of the wilderness to the Red Sea, and the sons of Israel went up into martial array from the land. They were wandering. Instead of taking the short route to the promised land, they took the long way. I prepared a map for you here. I want you to check this out. This is Egypt here. The red indicates the route to the promised land, Canaan, over here in the dark green. The blue indicates the route that they took, that God led them on. 40 years wandering in the wilderness when they could have made a straight trek that would have took a couple weeks to get there. God took them the long way because God was preparing you. You wondering why you feel like you going in circles and why you turning around and why you find yourself up and down and haven't gotten to the place yet. He's simply preparing you for where he's taking you. Where he's taking you to. But God, he has a plan for you in the midst of what you're going through. As a matter of fact, it's a setup. Tell somebody, it's a setup, it's a setup. God's about to set you up for something. And when you're in the midst of this setup, I want you to understand, it might not feel good to you, but it's gonna be good for you. And so what God did, if you looked at the map, he put them and wedged them into a ravine by the Red Sea. Red Sea in front of them, mountainous on each side. The Egyptians coming hard behind them. They're trapped in, and here comes the enemy. Nowhere to go. Anybody knows anything about war, you would never put yourself in a place where you have no room for retreat. You would never box yourself into a place of this nature. But God put them in this place that they couldn't get out of. Gonna help somebody out here, because sometimes God has set you up and you're in this place and you don't understand it, but God put you there. Have you ever considered that maybe you're right where God wants you? Even though that place you're at doesn't feel good to you, even though you're going through some stuff, that God is simply preparing you, maturing you, because God has a plan for you. The prophet Jeremiah says in Jeremiah 29, 11, he says, I know the plans that I have for you, declares the Lord, plans for welfare and not for calamity, to give you a future and a hope. He says, I got a plan for you, and his plans are better than our plans. He says, I got a plan. It's a setup. I know what I'm doing. That's what he's telling you. I know it don't seem like it. I know it seems like it's taking a long time, but God says, I know what I'm doing. I know exactly what I'm doing, because, listen, what God has for you is for you. And even though you're going through some stuff, it's preparing you. God has a way of taking the bad and working it out. You know what Romans 8, 28 says. Yes, for we know that all things work together for good. Hold on, let me pause, because some of y'all irritate me, because y'all be quoting my verse like it's an everybody verse. You find somebody going through something and you say, baby, all things work together for your good. Just saying it to everybody. Like you could just apply my verse to everybody. Tell somebody, don't be giving away my verse. That's my verse. That's my verse. That don't belong to everybody, because listen, the verse is conditional. It says, and for we know that all things work together for good to them that love God, to them who are called according to his purpose. If you love God and you're walking in purpose, then all things work together for your good. But if you don't love him, if you're a God hater, if you ain't in purpose, some stuff gonna be bad for you, boo. Some stuff gonna be bad. That's my verse. I like the way New Living says it. It says, and we know that God causes everything to work together for the good of those who love God and are called according to his purpose for them. In other words, it might not feel good to you, but it's good for you. It's like that castor oil your great grandmama used to make you take. Didn't taste good at all, but it was good for you. And sometimes some of the stuff that's best for us doesn't feel good going down. And some of the experiences in your life didn't feel good while you were in them. But God had a purpose. And let me tell you something, if God leaves you in it, you can handle it. I got some Bible, want to hear it, here it go. 1 Corinthians 10:13, no temptation has overtaken you, but such as is common to man. And God is faithful, who will not allow you to be tempted beyond what you are able, but with the temptation will provide the way of escape also so that you will be able to endure it. What the text is saying is God will not allow you to go through more than you can handle. And if it is more than you can handle, he's gonna give you a way to escape. So if God is keeping you in it, God believes you can handle it. Tell somebody, I can handle it. I can handle it. I can handle the trouble on my job. I can handle this mess that's going on in my family. I can handle it. You got to learn to how you stand in the midst of something. You ever ask somebody how they doing and they answer all right under the circumstances? And I'm going, what you doing under them? You supposed to be above and not beneath, the head and not the tail. What you doing under some circumstances if you supposed to be a child of God in this nature? And see, even when you look at the word circumstance and the etymology of the word, definition first is that a circumstance is a fact relating to another fact and modifying it. Okay, it's a fact that relates to another fact and modifies it. The word circumstance comes from two Latin words. The Latin root is circum and stare. Circum, where we get the word circumference, means that which is around you. Stire is stand or stance. So we understand in our mind circumstance meaning to be what's going on around you. And so we think that in order to change my circumstances, God needs to change what's going on around me. Well, remember, it's one fact relating to another fact. You could either change what's going on around you, or you could change the way you stand. So I might not be able to change my situation, but I can change how I stand and how I react to what's going on around me. I stand in faith in spite of what I see. I believe that God has healed me even when the symptoms still persist. I believe that God has made a way even when I haven't seen it. That's why I learned a little word, yet. He hadn't done it yet, but God is in process. So I learned to change my stance even when I can't change my circum. So then, and I said it this way, I like this example, don't let me leave it. Y'all know the difference between a thermostat and a thermometer. And too many Christians in here are thermometers instead of thermostats. Yeah, thermometer on the wall just reads the temperature. It just sucks in what's going on around it and reflects back to you, this is what the temperature of the room is. That's what a thermometer, but a thermostat, it can make adjustments to the atmosphere. And as a child of God, you ought to make some adjustments to the atmosphere. So you don't reflect back what's going on. If you walk in some place and everybody got an attitude, don't you cop an attitude too. When you walk in the place, you got to change the situation. Good morning, how y'all doing today? God bless you. Even that, y'all, anybody had that one coworker that don't ever speak? So then you stop speaking to them? No, you got to, with a smile on your face, God bless you, and how are you doing today? Come on with your thermostat self. You got to learn how to turn some stuff around. You got to learn how to stand differently in what you're going through. I was telling them, I had worked this one job where everybody around me was a heathen. Anybody ever been to that place? They just cussing and foul. Matter of fact, they knew I was a preacher. It seemed like when I come around, they would just increase the cussing and the acting a fool just because I was around. And so what I did, I said, I got to change the atmosphere. So I used to go to work early and pray in the place. I would take my anointing oil and anoint their desks and anoint their chairs and declare there was going to be some change in this place in there. And I would anoint and I would sit back and watch them come in and sit down. And see who jumped up like they just got burnt. Like, oh, that oil got you. I knew you was a demon. You gotta change what's going on around you. But until what's going on around me changes, I change my stance and I learn how to wait. Yeah, the prophet Isaiah, let me borrow him, chapter 40, verse 28. He says, "Hast thou not known, hast thou not heard, that the everlasting God, the Lord, the creator of the ends of the earth, fainteth not, neither is weary? There's no searching of his understanding. He giveth power to the faint, and to them that have no might, he increaseth strength. Even the YF shall faint and be weary. And the young men shall utterly fall." Here we go. "But they that wait on the Lord shall renew their strength. They shall mount up on wings as eagles. They shall run and not be weary. They shall walk and not faint." You got to learn how to wait on the Lord. See, here's our problem. We think the word wait is a passive word. We think that wait means sit back and don't do nothing. That's what we think. But have you ever wondered why when you go to a restaurant, the person who's taking care of you is called a waiter? Yeah. You got to learn how to wait. You got to learn how to wait. In the Hebrew, the word for wait is kwava. And it means to wait actively with anticipation, hopefully watching for God to act. Actively with anticipation. I don't wait passively. I wait actively. I move and keep going forward while I'm waiting for God to act. The word quava gives this kind of inference as if I am surrounding or wrapping myself around God. That God can strengthen me. I learn how to lean on him. It's this image. Anybody in the horticulture of a plant? And you have a plant that's drooping. What do you do when you have a plant that the stem is weak and the plant's kind of leaned over? That you take that plant and you put a stick next to it. And then you tie it to something. You tie that stick to that plant. So then what happens is the strength of the stick holds the plant up. And I'm trying to tell you to get tied up, tangled up, and wrapped up in Jesus, that the strength that comes from him can keep you standing in the midst of what you're going through. You got to learn how to quava, wait on him. Tell somebody, I'm quava right now. I'm quava. I'm leaning and depending, believing and hoping that God is going to show up on my behalf. And if you learn how to wait, God will move for you. Look here, Exodus 14. I gotta move. Look at the clock. It says Exodus 14, 13. "But Moses said to the people, do not fear. Stand by and see the salvation of the Lord, which he shall accomplish for you today. For the Egyptians, whom you have seen today, you will never see them again forever." You ain't catch that. He says, stand still. I know I left you in this for a while. I know you're trying to wonder and figure out why I set you up, but this setup was to bring some finality to the situation that you're going through. You'll never see them again forever. This is the last day you're going to have to deal with this. I came to prophetically decree to somebody that God is about to bring you out in order to bring you in, and this is the last day that you got to deal with and go through what you've been going through. Tell somebody, I won't go back. I won't. I refuse to go back. I'm pressing on with Jesus. I'm going to move forward. But listen here. It says, verse 13, the Lord will fight your battles while you keep silent. That's a big part of our problem. We don't know how to hush. We don't know how to let God handle it. You always trying to put your hands on it. You don't know how to let God drive. Some people got that dumb bumper sticker that said, God's my co-pilot. So why is that dumb? Because co-pilot follows the instruction of the pilot. If God is on board, sit back and let him drive. He's my pilot. He can be my chauffeur. Lead me, guide me, take me where you want me to go. We got to learn sometimes to give up control. And listen here, you've been messing up. Every time you touch it, you mess it up. Seems like you don't want to touch it no more anyway, considering all the times you done messed up. Be like, God, Jesus, take the wheel. Jesus, take the wheel. You got to learn how to, and keep silent. I know it's hard to believe, but I wasn't always saved. I know some of y'all came right out the womb speaking in tongues, and you were saved, coming on out, you ain't never done no harm, none of that stuff, but I had some ups and downs and some out times with God. And you know, when I first started dating First Lady, I remember when I first started dating her, I wasn't in church, but her daddy said, if you're gonna date my daughter, you're gonna have to go to church. I said, well, she fine. And if I gotta play this church game for a couple hours on Sunday in order to get what I'm trying to get to, I can play that game. So I went on to church, and next thing I know, I actually started listening to stuff. I became a junior deacon. Then when I went to the military and we were engaged, and when we finally got married and she came over to join me at my first duty station, she found out I was no longer a junior deacon. I was a junior demon. I was back to doing the dirt that I used to do, and she used to try to get me to go to church, and I'm like, I ain't going to church. I was sitting there watching the football game, drinking my drink and smoking my cigarette, the regular kind, not the funny kind, because I was in the military. I couldn't smoke the funny kind. But she would come home from church, and she would nag and complain when she come home. You just sitting here doing nothing. Just come in fussing. Then going to invite me to go back next week. I said, well, if church make you fuss like that, I don't want to go, because I'm sitting here full of joy. And you come home from church fussing. You want me to go to church so I can come home fussing too? And then somebody gave her some wise counsel. Said, baby, stop nagging him and just pray. So she got some other women together. They started praying for me, and she stopped nagging me and stopped fussing. And then all of a sudden, one Sunday, I said, I'm going to go on with you. And next thing you know, preacher, pastor, all of that, because she learned to keep quiet. Tell somebody, you might need to shut up. You might need to let God handle this one. You might need to keep silent. You might need to turn that child over to God. You might need to turn that husband over to God, that wife over to God, that situation. You need to give it to him. And if you take your hands off of it, God can move on your behalf. Ooh, I gotta go. I'm over time. So Exodus 14, 15 text says, then the Lord said to Moses, why are you crying out to me? Tell the sons of Israel to go forward. You got to make up your mind that I'm better than my past. I'm better than what I've been through. I refuse to go back. I won't go back. I'm going forward. I'm pressing forward with God. Too many times people keep going back to what they came out of. Because what happens in the in-between when you're going through, you start going through some stuff and you say to yourself, it was better when I was in it. I come out, I decided to get faithful, start coming to church, and then all of a sudden, all hell broke loose. Problem after problem, car breaks down, job lays me off, all these things happen, and you start looking at people out in the world, and they seem like they're doing better than you. That's the trick the enemy will play on you, is that he'll make you look to people outside and make you think everything's going all right. But you better watch, especially these Facebook and social media and Instagram fakes and phonies that like to present their life like it's wonderful. You don't know the real story in the first place. Better watch who you envy and who you want to be like, and you better lean and trust on God, and you got to make up your mind, I ain't going back. Mm-mm, I got out of this. I'm not going back. I like what Peter says in 2 Peter 2, 22. He says, it has happened unto them according to the true proverb. A dog returns to his own vomit, and a sow after washing returns to wallow in the mire. It's an interesting statement, Peter. And Peter's my favorite disciple because Peter would fight and cuss. And so he reminds me of myself sometimes. And So Peter gives this example. He says, the dog returns to his own vomit, and the sow, after it's washed, goes back to wallowing in the mud. And I wonder why. First of all, I know the example is that dogs and pigs were considered unclean animals. And so the Jewish people didn't mess with them. But also, look at the example. The dog returns to his vomit. Now, the dog returns to his vomit because he doesn't know that's what was making him sick. Anybody ever been sick and then you threw up and you feel better? Only a couple of you. Let me say it this way. Anybody been drunk? And then you throw up and you feel better? Oh, I got a few more amen. Don't look at me with your Holy Ghost face acting like you ain't never been tipsy. You ain't never drunk too much. You ain't never been sitting there where the room was spinning and you was feeling like, but soon as you got done praying through the porcelain God, that you feel better, because it was what was in you was making you sick, and once you threw it up, you felt better. But here it was, for the dog, the vomit tastes good to him. And because it tastes good and he didn't realize what was making him sick, he go right back to it again. Why are you looking at that dog like that? Because you keep going back to him. And you said he make you sick. Huh? You keep going back to her. I thought she made you sick. But you keep going back again and again. Dog. Then there's this pig that after it gets clean, it go back to the mud. Here's what I found out. Pigs don't have sweat glands. See, I'm up here sweating, because when you get hot, it's your body's attempt to cool off that you sweat. And because the pig doesn't have sweat glands, it doesn't have a way to cool off. So when the pig is hot and bothered, it goes and wallows in the mud. Why are you looking at that pig like that? Knowing that you've been wallowing in sin because you hot and bothered. And even though you get cleaned up and you say, this is the last time I'm gonna do this. This is the last time that I'm gonna go here. That's the last time there. You find yourself, when you get hot and bothered, right back in the mud. Here, piggy, 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 piggy. But you gotta make it, man. I'm not going back. I refuse to go back. It took too much to get out of it. And considering all the stuff I went through to get out of it, I'm not gonna go back. And what you gotta understand, that you don't turn a stumble into a complete fall. What do you mean? What do you mean? Because sometimes what you did is you've taken 4 or 5 steps forward and you stumble a little bit and take 1 step back. Don't make that be your excuse that you go completely back, say, no, I step back, but know what? I'm going forward because I ain't going back no more. Just a little stumble. I had a little bump in the road, but I'm going to keep pressing on with God. I'm going forward. Somebody say forward march. Ooh, I'm going forward with God, because I'm going to prophesy and get out of here. I'm going to tell you that what's coming is better than what's been. That God has a plan for you. And if you will put your hope and your trust in him, and you will learn to lean and depend on God, he'll keep you in the midst of what you're going through. He'll sustain you even in that middle place, that in-between place where you can't see your way out of it. God will keep you. Because he says, I know the plans I have for you, declares the Lord. Plans for welfare, not for calamity. To give you a future hope. Job says, Job 8:7, though your beginning was insignificant, your end will increase greatly. We know how the story ended with the children of Israel. Exodus 14:21 says, then Moses stretched out his hand over the sea, and the Lord swept the sea back by a strong east wind all night and turned the sea into dry land, so the waters were divided. The sons of Israel went through the midst of the sea on the dry land, and the waters were like a wall to them on their right hand and on their left. God made a road through a sea. He opened a way where there was no way, because the people learned to trust on him and how to stand in the midst of what they're going through. And I come to encourage somebody and let you know that even in what you're going through, that God can make a way out of no way. I asked the praise team, I had called Elder George, and said, do that song in the middle. And it wasn't because the song went with my message. It was because my message went with the song. See, you heard Pastor talk about it in the introduction. You know, when I was in Japan and pastoring there and we transitioned back here, but it wasn't a planned transition. The pandemic happened, and in the midst of the pandemic, stuff closed down and put off limits and things of this nature that we went into a place where we couldn't pay our bills. The monthly rent on our church was $26,000 a month. And when people couldn't come out, we weren't getting that. Our daycare, which had normally brought in about $40,000 a month, it decreased to where it was only bringing in about $10,000. And because we were foreigners in Japan, when they gave relief money to companies, we didn't get none. And so we had to make a decision about what we were going to do. And I thought the pandemic was just going to last for a couple months. And so we were holding on and saying, we're going to come out of this. But that thing just drug on and drug. And so we began to pray, what we're going to do? And God said, get thee up from out of Japan and go back. And I didn't want to hear it. Like, we shut everything down. It was my mindset that I was going to have a legacy, that I was going to hand this over to somebody else. But we shut everything down and we came back. And when I first came back, trying to find some place to work, job, so we can maintain the same lifestyle. My wife followed me around from military to ministry for over 30 years, and she deserves some nice things because she put up with me. And putting in these applications, and wasn't nobody hitting me back. And I'm looking here like, I got 4 college degrees. I got several master level certifications, and I ain't getting no hits. And so finally I took a position that was, as we would say, beneath me. And I'm wondering, and what's going on? And I'm in this place, and we had some savings, and that's starting to dwindle. And I was questioning God. Don't look at me like that, like you ain't never questioned God. And recite back to him how faithful you've been and how you've been serving him and doing all this. And I made all these sacrifices for you, stayed over here in Japan, all this, missed out on stuff serving you. This how you gonna do me? And came to church and they were singing that song, and God of the middle. And it did something to help me, my faith, and let me know that God is still God in the midst of what you're going through. And let me tell you that it was some time, but God did a suddenly. So I saw this position come up, my current position, and I put in from it. From the day I put my application in to the day I got hired was 2 weeks for the federal government. Anybody know about the federal government? They don't move that fast ever. Not at all. So they hired me and gave me this 6-figure plus salary. And then, yeah. Because God, who began a good work in you, is faithful to perform it until the day of Jesus Christ. You got to make up your mind. I ain't going back. I'm going forward. I'm going to trust him right where I am. Do I have anybody in here that's willing to lean and depend on God? Come on, stand with me. I'm way over time. Well, I hope you enjoyed that worshiping word on today. Listen, I want to thank you for joining us online. And listen, while you're there online, again, as I asked you in the beginning, won't you like, comment, and subscribe to our YouTube channel where you can get regular updates and join us weekly and see what God is doing here at the Word Church, where you could become part of the Word Nation. God bless you.